Up Close is presented by Tennova Healthcare, with 6 hospitals and more than 1,000 dedicated physicians. For more information, tennova.com.
Thanks for joining us for this edition of Up Close. I'm Stephanie Aldrich. This week, the music and performances of Celtic Thunder through the eyes of 2 of the artists. Since its start in 2007, Celtic Thunder has found appeal way beyond the performers' home countries of Ireland and Scotland. Their tours take them on the worldwide stage. And we're proud to say their shows have been featured many times right here on PBS. George Donaldson and Neil Byrne have been a part of each one of those PBS programs, including the most recent, called Mythology. Between promoting their latest album and DVD and setting out on their North American tour, they talk to us about their shoot to stardom, along with the music and the meaning behind Mythology.
I was sort of living a dream. I was a musician for such a long time, struggling musician, playing in bars and clubs all around the country. And I found it was the most exciting thing that I'd ever done. You know, the big stage, my dream, this is what I wanted to do. And, you know, Celtic Thunder have traveled down this road for 5 years. And I was always of the opinion the first show was the best. And the other shows, which we recorded on tour. So I think it's a harder thing to do when you're on tour, is to record the show.
Because so, that first feeling is so hard to top, right?
Yes, that is. I mean, honestly, that is exactly it. It's so hard to think, how could we ever top that initial excitement of something? I think Mythology took us back in a huge way to the roots of Celtic Thunder and what originally we'd set out to be. So there were the individual characters were regained their initial strength and what they were set out to be. And again, it was like Celtic music is all about telling stories. It's all about stories and song, just talking about the history of the country, any of the Celtic nations, and, you know, bringing a lot of the old songs out of the archives, the tradition, and really bringing that whole Celtic story, that whole Celtic dream, the whole Celtic feeling to other places around the world. So that's where Mythology, I would say it's the most, apart from their initial show, it was the most thought out one.
Neil, in one of your blogs, that you wrote that over the past year, one of the hardest things for you to do personally was to kind of keep the details of Mythology under wraps. Why was that?
It was a nightmare just staying silent, you know, for over a year. I mean, the concept of Mythology is well over a year old, and it was, you know, blood, sweat and tears working on it, you know, to get it the very best we could. It's based on a collaboration, you know, of the best people in the business in Europe have worked on this show with us. Also, for the first time we were involved very, very highly in musical arrangements, choreography and everything you see on the show. So, I mean, in the past, like all of the other shows we've done, well, apart from the first one, we have filmed on the road. So there was a crowd with us. They knew about the show, you know, over this side of the world. For us to film it at home was great to have our own crowd there. But remaining side, we were told, say nothing about rehearsals, say nothing about studio recording, say nothing, because we're used to being, you know, doing a lot of social networking.
That's what I was going to say. In this day and age, that's a tall order.
It is, you know, and it was sort of like, you know, when you're putting up your tweets, you know, well, I was playing a game of tennis today, I was playing a golf today, where you are, you're in the studio, you know, you're working on this fantastic show. All you want to do is talk about it, get it out there, tell people about it, you know. So it was so difficult and unnatural not to tell people about it for over a year.
When you see it, you can see why it took a year when all of that hard work for it to come together for the end product.
You know, yeah, and especially, you know, after the filming, when we seen even the rough edits of it, you know, we were just going, this is the biggest and best show we have done, hands down, you know, and we were just so, so proud of it.
I know this is probably kind of hard, George, but can you pick a favorite song that you performed in Mythology?
On the ensemble pieces, there are some real fiery, adrenaline-driving songs in the show. There's a Rocky Road to Dublin and Star of the County Down. I mean, I used to start every solo gig I'd done at home when I would do it, when I was playing the bars and clubs, with the Star of the County Down. So it was good to have that in. And
so you have a little history with some of these, and
yeah,
so it means something to you.
I used to joke about it. I used to have to do the least homework recording the show because I've been singing so many of the songs for so long. But Rocky Road to Dublin, I think, is a great, fiery song. It's just, it's actually about a fight somewhere along the line, a feuding kind of story going on. On the rocky road to Dublin, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Hot the hair and turn it down the rocky road, and all the way to Dublin, back for Lollyra.
In Mullingar that night to wrestle him, so weary started by daylight. Next morning bright and early, took a drop of the pure to keep me heart from sinking, that's the Paddy score. When Airy's on for drinking to see the lassie smile, laughing all the while, up me curious thought, was set your heart to bubble and asked if I was hard. Wages I required till I was almost tired of the rocky road to double him. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Neil, do you have a favourite from the show? Can you narrow it down?
There's so many, you know, and it's not necessarily one of my own, but one I love to sing myself is, I think we all have big connections with our solo songs. That's why they work so well for us, you know. One of which for me has been Summer in Dublin. It's a song recorded by and written by Liam Riley, a member of a band called Bagatelle. And years ago, my dad toured with them with his own band, did a big tour of the UK and Ireland. And I know some of the players in Bagatelle myself. Summer in Dublin was one of their biggest hits. And it describes the city, you know, living in the city and having a break from the city, getting out into the countryside. And that's what it's all about in Ireland, you know. Plus, one of the guys in the band used to do sound for some of the gigs that I played on, you know. It talks of Dunleary, where I'm from. And just the melody of the song itself is absolutely gorgeous.
And the lift ears, it stank like hell. The young people walking on Bradford Street, everyone looking so well. I was singing a song I heard somewhere called Rock and Roll Never Forgets. And my lip was smothered by a 46.
So that's one for me. On the other hand, one of the up-tempo songs I have is a song called Perfect by a band called Fairground Attraction, a Scottish band. And it was their biggest hit, and it's a real pop song. But it was lovely to do that song again because it meant me playing guitar on it. And I was the guitar player in the band for 3 years. And it really showcases as well the band getting around me and how interactive the band are as well, and great players, you know. So a great vibe to the song, a really great vibe. It's probably the most fun I've ever had with a solo song is the song Perfect.
They make such mistakes, 'cause their minds too eager to give that love away. Now I've been foolish.
Well, George, I want to go back a few years because you came to the group in maybe not so much of a traditional way mm-hmm. as everyone else, and I understand that you're really self-taught and you were motivated to do this at a very young age. You weren't getting formal lessons or anything, were you?
Yeah, when I think the first time I picked a guitar up, I would be about 13 or 14 years old, and I'm one of nine children. I'm the sixth of nine, and I always found it funny, like my mum and my dad would be paying for guitar lessons for the other members of the family, but the guitar used to lie in the corner and no one ever practiced, and it just lay there. And I thought, you know, it'd be interesting, just I think maybe out of curiosity, just to see how it worked. And I remember going over to the library. I didn't have any money, so I went over to the library and I got a book from the library. Spent a lot of time, it came with a tape, how to tune a guitar. Then the first chords, and as I've said before, I remember playing an A minor and a C and thinking, oh, I mean, it sounds amazing. These were the first chords. And it was a book by Neil Diamond. The first song was Song Sung Blue, which I don't even think I knew the song. But it was just working at the chords, and I thought, this is the best thing ever. And I remember going to Spain on holiday a few years after that, and I seen a guy singing in an Irish bar, no less. I had everyone on their feet, and he was singing Leaving on a Jet Plane, American Pie, Whiskey in the Jar, and Irish Rover, and Caledonia. And he had everybody in the palm of his hands, and I thought, you know, I was 17 or 18, I thought, this is what I want to do with my life. And eventually get myself into playing bars and clubs. And, you know, I think like any musician, you always want to take your craft to a new level, take your music to a new height, you try writing songs, you're singing, you change your style, you try and get better. But I think as time went on, I certainly thought I would get somewhere as a musician, but as time went on, I thought I had missed the boat.
And you were doing something very different at this point. When you say you thought you missed the boat, you were building buses in a factory.
Yeah.
And then doing the singing rather casually.
Yeah.
On the side.
I'd be singing at a weekend, working in bars and clubs, and working in a factory because, I mean, I'm married now for 21 years this year. I've got a 12-year-old daughter, so I mean, there's an awful lot of responsibilities. You can't just live the
You're supporting your family.
Yeah, the life of a musician when bills don't get paid. But so I had my job and I was working in the evening, still chasing the musical dream. And the auditions were, I had a radio commercial that just says they were looking for musicians from the age of 18 to 45, Celtic backgrounds, and so I went along for the audition. The funniest thing I heard was when they came, they wanted four Irish guys and one Scottish guy, and the Scottish guy, they wanted him to be 6 foot two, be from a Celtic background, who could sing, not necessarily play the guitar, but they wanted him to be 6 foot two with flaming red hair, like something from Braveheart. So as I ticked most of the boxes.
So I was going to say, so you thought you fit most of that bill.
Yeah. So it was basically, that was the interview, sort of the audition. Then I was back to Dublin for the sort of closing auditions. And, you know, basically the rest is history.
So you went from being this regular guy doing this physical work. Do you ever draw on those experiences as a musician or writing your own songs and things today? Does it, you know, come back into this very glamorous life now, looking back on what you did these other years?
You know what, the interesting thing about, as the musician side of it, when I'm not on tour with Celtic Thunder, I do go back to a lot of the places that I play, and I like, if nothing else, the 20 years of what I used to do with the factory and with playing all the bars and clubs. And I know the rest of the guys done that kind of thing too, but it certainly keeps you grounded. I love being with Celtic Thunder. Being on tour is amazing. It's a great bunch of guys that we all go on tour with. And you know, from the backroom staff to the crew members, to the office staff, to everyone involved. We all get on really well, and it's like being on tour with your family. But then on the other side of that, when I go home, I'm with my family, and I like just stepping back from it and just come back, get the guitar, sing a few songs in a bar, and just be the way things used to be.
Neil, you realized your musical talents pretty early on, maybe in a little bit more traditional way, and your father was really instrumental in that, wasn't he?
He was indeed. My dad was a professional musician all his life, you know, and he's been my biggest influence in music, you know, all my life. I remember when I started banging on suitcases on the bedroom floor, playing along to records all the time, you know. Then when I was big enough to hold a guitar, that's when I started playing the guitar. And I remember my dad's first guitar is his old Fender Telecaster there, you know. I wasn't let touch that, but he had an old acoustic there that I used to play on until he bought me my own guitar when I was about, I think it was about seven.
And when you're a teenager, like maybe most teens dream, was your dream to be more of a pop star? Could you imagine that you might have been eventually putting a new twist on more traditional Celtic music? Was that even a thought that much at that point, a little bit?
Yeah, back in my teenage years, I didn't really play much Celtic and Irish music. Always loved it. But I always played the music with my own bands. The music that I would write was actually more American influenced. The likes of Billy Joel, Earth, Wind and Fire, Stevie Wonder, Steely Dan, all that type of sort of 70s pop funk.
Who have influenced a lot of people.
Yeah, so that's what I played for many, many years. And I still write a lot of music like that too. But, you know, when I met Phil and got into, I played bass in Phil's band, and as I said, we did an American tour, and that sort of introduced me more to the Celtic side of things, which he introduced me to Celtic Thunder. So I came in, and I was the lead guitar player in Celtic Thunder for the first 3 years.
And you did some backup vocals as
I used to do the backup
right?
vocals in studio as well, yeah. And then I think it was the third and fourth year I started collaborating a bit with the guys and getting up and going out front and singing some of the ensemble songs, and then got one or two solo songs. And it was only over the last couple of years, Sharon Brown, our producer, as says, Neil, you know, I'd like to see how you get on up front, you know.
And I want to walk back up that hill. I'll just get on the road and I'll stick out my thumb, 'cause I know for sure you'll be there still. I remember that summer in Dublin, and the leafies, it stank like hell, and the young people walking on Grafton Street, everyone looking so well. And so I jumped on a bus to Dunleary.
And what has it been like for you to see your music with the Celtic roots just gain in popularity so much in so many countries?
Our records have been sold all over the world, and it's expanding all the time. You know, but I just think, you know, that those Celtic roots are all over the world, you know. It's huge. And I'm only learning that myself, how big it is, you know. So it's and it is due to the beauty of the Celtic music is fantastic. You know, some of the old Irish airs, I think, are some of the most beautiful music you'll ever hear.
George, what do you think it is about Celtic music and culture that translates to so many people, even if the family tree isn't even a little mm-hmm. bit Irish or Scottish? I'll make sure mm-hmm. and say that, because you're the lone Scot in the group. They got to give you a hard time about that sometimes. But what do you think it is about that culture that so many people just enjoy and want to connect with?
I think even though you're saying it's not the heritage reasons, I think wherever Celtic Thunder go, and it's mostly in the States, Canada and Australia at the moment, there is a huge amount of people who claim Celtic heritage. So, I mean, initially I would say that's one of the main reasons for it. But again, I think the reason Celtic music is so popular at home in the Celtic countries is because it is, it's great music. It's music that takes you on a roller coaster, basically.
I saw a horse outside the door where my old horse should be. Well, I called me wife and I says to her, will you kindly tell to me who owns that horse outside the door where my old horse should be?
Ah, you drunk, you silly old fool, still you cannot see. That's a lonely sow that me mother said to me. Well, it's many a day I've travelled 100 miles or more, but a saddle on a sow, sure, I never saw before.
Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling from glen to glen and down the mountain side. The summer's gone and all the flowers are dying. Must go and I must bide.
Do you think that musicians today have more pressure to be in so many places at once? And what I mean by that is the so many media platforms. You don't just have the performances, the CD, the DVD, but it seems like there's almost this other layer of fan experiences that's almost an expectation now.
I do. It's you know, in one sense, like the internet, it has made the world such a small place. You know, and to get your music out there, you know, and if it's good enough, it will get out there to people, you know. It means having to be creative.
Well, is there something maybe that fans don't know, maybe the less glamorous side of things sometimes, of just keeping up with a grueling schedule? What is it that maybe fans don't see or don't realize when they see your shows and or watch you on PBS or see a DVD? What do you guys think?
You know, what people see is when they come to a show, they see the guys on stage. What they don't see is the guys who built the stage, the guys that are involved in the lighting. We show up at 9 o'clock in the morning when the venue opens, and quite often we don't have to do anything until 3 or 4 o'clock. But the other guys are there first thing in the morning. They're the first guys in, the last guys out. So I think when people see that kind of thing happening, there's a lot more goes into a show than just the guys you see on stage. And it all has to be sorted so that there's as few mistakes as possible. So I think there would be a kind of a reality view of it to see, you know, realistically, this is the way the whole thing works. It's not just show up and then everyone gets home and that lasted 2 hours. Mm-hmm. That whatever happened in the 2 hours took all day. So maybe people will realise or see what's actually behind a show. Not just ours. I mean, that would just be, it would be an example of just about every show that's out there.
Neil, to George's point, do you think that it's just interesting for people to see, for each one of you guys, you have a host of people backing you up every time you guys go out there?
We do, yeah. And I mean, you can just, you know, for the likes of Mythology, there's a perfect thing to look at. Example, you know, when you look at the imagery behind the set, you know, what goes on, the building of the set, you know, there's so many people involved, and it's we're actually in awe of them, you know, of what they've brought, with the spectacle they've brought here for us, you know.
Thank you.
you guys ever argue behind the scenes? That's my song. I want it. No, I'm going to sing it better than you. Any of that ever go on? A little bit?
No.
Never?
No. No, we're pretty good. We're pretty good like that, you know.
It's hard. Do you know, it's hard to be on the road for a long time together. And I think what you do have to learn is... when arguments come up, you know, you have to learn to step back, and compromise is the biggest thing that you can have when you're on tour. And so you can't own a song. You can wish that you had a song, because even if, I know Mythology is a good example of it, some of the songs that you thought you might not have delivered as well as you was, maybe not your first choice. I mean, you maybe say that would have suited better than that one, but when you hear it on the night, you think, you know, I'm so glad I took that one. And you know, I actually quite like the song that he was doing. Boy, do I love it now, if you know what I mean, because it's the way songs are produced, and you can't take someone else's song, but I think you can certainly have a lot of respect and love for what you're hearing for someone else's song. Now, I think a lot of what we sing is so geared up to the type of people we are, so, I mean, I think, as I mentioned earlier, I would sing both sides, and it would take an experienced person in life to deliver that or feel comfortable in talking about both sides of life. Whereas young Colm, I'm sure he would sing a good job of it, but he wouldn't be singing from experience, he'd be singing a song, basically. Sure. So there's a lot of songs relate to the people that we are.
Neil, do you think sometimes, boy, this one has George written all over it, or any of the other principal members, do you
Absolutely.
Just sometimes, hey, this is great, I like it, but really, I really think this belongs to somebody else.
Completely. Like when we were putting all the song suggestions forward for Mythology, we'd over 200 songs. And it was just like, you know, any songs that we thought might be really, really good for the show, we'd put them forward, and it would have nobody's name on them, you know, but we'd bring them forward to the powers that be to say, listen, these are great songs. Who do you think this would be really good for, you know? So, yeah, it's not just like, oh, that'd be a great song for me, or this one or that one, you know. It is complete collaboration of work, you know. And basically, out of 200 songs, the 37 that were picked pretty much jumped off the page for the personalities, like both sides.
That's
nailed.
Still hard to narrow it down.
It is hard to narrow down, yeah, because there's always a few that gets left behind that you might personally love yourself, you know. But I think in all, deciding and narrowing it down, we really pretty much hit the nail on the head for the right songs for every personality.
You know, House of the Rising Sun is a great example of that. I've been singing that song. It's one of the first songs you would learn on the guitar because of the chord progressions. It's a nice chord progression that you could relate to a song that was really famous. And I've been singing that for such a long time. And I know that I put that song into the melting pot of maybe me singing it. And Ryan was the guy who got that one. And I thought, yeah, that's an example of your question was, you know, I would like to have sung that. But then I heard him singing it, I thought, that's great. You know, he does a great job. Then I heard it in the show and I thought, there's no one else would have done it better.
My mother was a tailor. She sewed my new blue jeans. My father was a gambling man down in New Orleans.
Well, Neil, you had a little bit of a transition going from, you know, the backup vocals to guitar to then being front and center with everyone. And you touched on this earlier about just having to deal with changes of members of the group from mm-hmm. time to time. And you had mentioned, too, that you felt like this is just a really good example of having those people come together and a few new faces coming together and making it work. And it's a transition nonetheless, though.
Yeah, I think from the very initial concept of it, the five guys that were on stage, we all got on great. And I think the first time I ever met them, I just thought, how could I be with these other vocalists? We have pretty much nothing in common vocally, age-wise either. I don't know what would be getting... I don't mean soul, but you know, what would be musically getting put across. And I couldn't believe it. I think it comes down an awful lot of the time to the professionalism of the singer as well as the musician on stage. We spent a lot of time working together and making sure the vocals could blend. You have a strong accent, as I've been told often enough, and people saying, I can't understand you now and again. But I think so, using that as an example, you would hear other guys singing, and not necessarily their accent, because there is a kind of blended accent when singers, when they sing. But we had to put all that together and we made it work. And I think that was something very special to come from backgrounds that were so different musically, so different vocally, and make them blend.
and I'm sure you're glad that, Neil is right up there next to you now as well.
Yeah, and nice off. We would always be singing songs, and we'd always hear Neil singing something. And it was an early idea, and when the opportunity came up, he was the first man to jump at it.
That's wonderful. And I do want to mention that both Neil and George, you guys have been a part of every single Celtic Thunder show that has ever aired on PBS, and I just felt like that was noteworthy and worth saying, and we're just so glad that you're a part of the PBS family. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
And thank you very much.
And it seems the anticipation of Mythology has the approval of Thunderheads. The album reached number one on the Billboard charts for Top World Album. And the Celtic Thunder guys will be touring, so look for them in your city. I'm Stephanie Aldrich. Be sure and join us next week for another edition of Up Close.
Up Close is presented by Tennova Healthcare, with 6 hospitals and more than 1,000 dedicated physicians. For more information, tennova.com.